Hello, hello everyone. Today we are going to talk about the one-way ANOVA and what we need to think about when we run one. As I mentioned in the video about the student t-test, it is easy to do stats to produce a p-value, especially with Prism, but it is difficult to do good stats, as in stats we can believe to actually quantify how much we can trust what our data are telling us. So here is what we are going to talk about. First, we will look at what question an ANOVA is actually answering. Then we will see how it works and we will talk about the things that are important to keep in mind when we run an ANOVA. We will also talk about Familywise error rate, which sounds scary but is actually pretty straightforward. And finally, just for fun, we will run an ANOVA together. In a nutshell, we use a one-way ANOVA when we want to know if there are significant differences between the means of several groups of values. Now, we are not talking about any values. First, the values need to be continuous, so our data needs to be quantitative. Second, we are not talking about any quantitative data. We want ours to be well-behaved, or more specifically, we want them to meet certain assumptions. And we want that because the one-way ANOVA belongs to the parametric family. It means it is happy to deal with data which show normality and homogeneity of variance, which are the assumptions I was talking about, by the way. I explain more about assumptions for parametric tests in the video on data exploration, which is an important complement to this one. Now, stats are all about understanding and controlling variation, and to do that, difference and variability are often combined into a ratio, referred to as the signal-to-noise ratio. Many parametric statistical tests, such as the ANOVA, are variation on the theme of that ratio, which we want big, right? A big difference between the groups of values and very little variability in it, so that we can discriminate between them. Okay, so it comes from physics, and these guys say that if the noise is low, then the signal is detectable, and bingo, for us, that is statistical significance. But if the noise, for example, the inter-individual variability, is high, then the same signal will not be detected and we don't reach statistical significance. And the ANOVA is pretty much about that. The signal will be the difference between the group means and the noise, the variability within the groups. And the ratio of the two will give us F, which is the statistic produced by the ANOVA. Now, let me show you how it works. You are going to love it. So let's imagine that we have five groups of values, A to E, and we want to see if there are differences between these groups. Whatever package or software we use to run an ANOVA, at one stage, we will get a table like this one. And in real life, we would go straight for the p-value here. But today, I want to show you how to get that p-value so that you understand fully what the ANOVA does. The first thing it does is to quantify the total amount of noise in the data. So all the values, regardless of the group to which they belong, are put together, and the mean of these values is calculated. That's the grand mean. Then the differences from each point and that mean are calculated. Here we have 77 values, so that's 77 differences, which are squared and summed up, and it gives us the sum of squared errors, or the sum of squares in short, which is 69.9 in this example. By the way, I explain why the differences are called errors, or sometimes residuals, in the video on descriptive statistics. Next, we want to look at the differences between the groups. So, the same thing is done, but this time between each of the five means and that same grand mean. It gives us five differences, which we square and add up. That is the sum of squares between the groups. Finally, we do the same one last time, but this time within each group, where the differences between each value and the group to which it belongs are calculated and again squared and added up. That's the within groups sum of squares. Okay, so now remember, we want to compare the signal with the noise, the difference between the means with the variability within the groups. But with the values we have here, we cannot do it because we cannot compare sums from groups of different sizes. To be able to make such a comparison, we need to divide the sums by the size of the samples from which they are calculated. Here, we don't actually divide these sums by the sample sizes, but by the number of degrees of freedom n-1. In doing so, we get the mean squares, which are also quite simply the variances, hence analysis of variance. Haha! If you want to know more about variance and degrees of freedom, check out the video on descriptive stats, which is a really good complement for this one, as I mentioned earlier. Anyway, one last step, the calculation of the F ratio, which is quite simply the ratio of the variance between the groups and the one within the groups. And if we want to reach significance, we want that ratio to be big, right? Big difference between the groups and small variability within, and that's what we got here. Okay, so far so good. We have a p-value which tells us that there is a difference between the groups overall. But what we want more often than not is the significance about pairwise comparisons, like are groups B and C different from group A, for instance. So now we need to talk about family-wise error rate. And why is that? Well, because running multiple tests on the same data increases the family-wise error rate. Okay, so to understand that concept, we need to talk about probability for a minute. Now, do not be alarmed, it is dead easy. We have to think about one of the basic rules or laws of probabilities. The multiplicative rule, the probability of the joint occurrence of two or more independent events, is the product of the individual probabilities. So for example, if we throw a coin twice, the probability of having two heads in a row is simply the multiplication of the two individual probabilities. And never forget to be intuitive. It is less likely to get two heads than one, hence the probability is smaller. Make sense? Now let's apply it to the ANOVA. Let's say that we have three groups and we want to compare them all to one another. Now let's look at the type 1 error, which should never be above 5%, right? To get through that example, it is actually easier to think about the probability of not making the type 1 error, which is then 95% or more. If we apply the multiplicative rule here, then when running three independent pairwise comparisons, the overall probability of no type 1 error is 0.857. So, if we reverse back to know the probability of making at least one type 1 error, we get 0.143 or 14%. The probability has increased from 5% to 14%. So, this is the family-wise error rate, which increases proportionally to the number of comparisons run within a given data set. The solution to the increase of family-wise error rate is to correct for multiple comparisons, and the stringency of the correction will have to be directly proportionate to the number of comparisons. So, over the years, statisticians have developed different ways to correct for multiple comparisons, each addressing a different issue, unbalanced design, some heterogeneity in variance, for instance. I am not going to go into details about each possible correction, but so that you get a feel about how it is done, I am going to take an example. I am going to choose Carlo Bonferroni's correction because it is the easiest, we can even do it by hand. The guy chose an approach totally brilliant in its simplicity. He thought, right, the more comparisons I make, the more likely I am to make the type 1 error. So easy, to have a stringency directly proportionate to the number of comparisons I am making, I am going to divide the threshold for significance by the number of comparisons. So if I have three comparisons, for instance, the threshold will be 0.016. In practice, people do it the other way around, actually. They multiply the p-values by the number of comparisons, so 3, for example, here, and then compare the p-values to the classic 5%. Much more intuitive. Okay, so totally brilliant, but very conservative, hence leading to loss of power and lots of false negatives. For 10 comparisons, for instance, the threshold for significance is 0.005, so super hard to reach significance. That's why, as the number of comparisons increases, people tend to choose less conservative corrections, like the Tukey one, for instance, which, as you can see here, is less stringent. By the way, if you're a bit shaky about these concepts, check out the video on power. Okay, now enough theory, let's do it. We are going to look at the effect of diet on lobster's weight and why not. Before doing any stat, however, remember the cardinal rule, data exploration. As I said before, the ANOVA is a parametric test. So it only works on data which show normality and homogeneity of variance. A quick look here is enough to reassure us. Even if the samples are small, the data do not seem to behave in a dodgy way. We can also see that the three diets are mussels, pellets, and flakes. Now, the ANOVA is a two-step analysis. First, we have the omnibus test, that's step one, which tells us about the overall difference between the means, but not which means are significantly different from which other. We saw how it works a few slides ago. And then step two, post-hoc test, from the Latin meaning after the event. So test we run after the ANOVA itself. These will tell us if there are differences between the means pairwise, and the correction for multiple comparisons will be applied to the p-values. These post-hoc tests should only be used when the ANOVA finds a significant effect. To run an ANOVA in Prism is intuitive and relatively straightforward. First, we need to pick ANOVA in colon stats. Then Prism wants to know about the design of the experiment and also about the assumptions, so normality and homogeneity of variance. Then we need to pick the pairwise comparisons we're interested in. That is not stats business. It is about the original questions behind the design and should be decided before collecting the data. Here I went for comparing all the diets together because it made sense to me. Then we choose which correction we want to use, and remember that some are more conservative than others. Whatever we choose, it is important to be consistent across a manuscript or a paper. Finally, we can choose to check the assumptions graphically. Here I chose the QQ plots because it is kind of cool. I also ticked to get diagnostics for residuals. I explain more about residuals and QQ plots in the video on descriptive stats, which once again is a really good complement to this one. Okay, so the ANOVA is a two-step analysis, so Prism gives us two tabs. Let's go through the first one, ANOVA results. First, the assumptions. Let's check that we can trust what the ANOVA will tell us before getting excited. So here, Prism offers four tests to check out the first assumptions. And few, they all agree to say all good. The QQ plot looks a bit bumpy, but the residuals line up nicely, so still okay. Second assumption, homogeneity of variance. Prism offers two tests here, Brown Forsyth and the Bartlett test. Again, they agree to say that the data meets the second assumption. Now, the p-values for all these tests are not significant because there is no significant departure for normality, nor is there a significant difference in variability between the three groups of values, which is what we want. Then the ANOVA table, which we are familiar with now, with the sum of squares, the degrees of freedom, and the mean squares. Because the F ratio and the P value are usually the bits people get excited about, they are also reported at the top. Finally, the pairwise comparisons. I went for Tukey here, and we can see that lobsters get significantly fatter on mussels than flakes, or is it that they eat more of the former because they prefer it? Anyway, they seem to do okay with pellets too. There you go. Thank you for listening. And don't forget, stats don't have to be scary.